like an iris rhizome, you know. Turmeric is also a rhizome. It's that, it's stem tissue that grows along the surface of the soil, and that's where those aromatic and coloring chemicals are. It's really important in curries. I mean, curry wouldn't be curry without turmeric. It's been cultivated for 5,000 years, give or take a few thousand. In the Middle Ages, was called Indian saffron because it colored food yellow. It was, well, it was a less expensive substitute for saffron, which you know is the stamen of a crocus, which is collected by hand at the base of the Himalayas, and it's really special. Turmeric, the little brown rhizomes at the top of the picture are the turmeric rhizomes, and then they've been sliced to show that orangey interior flesh. And the flesh is boiled and then dried and ground. And that's the pile of dust at the bottom of the picture is the resulting ground turmeric. So it's amazing to think that this plant is, it's pretty processed. Between, you know, it growing in South Asia and then coming to us in a can or a jar. And yet it still packs a pretty potent punch in terms of aroma and flavor. Turmeric is also, so what I love is it does triple duty. It's ornamental and it grows really well in our conservatory because we love plants that are low maintenance and that have flowers. It's edible, it's an important food crop, and it's also medicinal. It's been used, again, for about 5,000 years, and it's important in Ayurvedic medicine as an anti-inflammatory, which is also supposed to help soothe digestion. So it's great. So it's like if you're overeating, but you're eating turmeric, hopefully it'll help you feel better. And so you don't suffer the consequences of your food choices. It's also an antiseptic and an antioxidant, and it is being looked at in relation to its effect on prolactin in the brain, as in Alzheimer's, and also arthritis and cancer and all sorts of things. So and then it's also used to color mustard. So you've been eating it your whole life, even if you don't eat ethnic foods. If you eat hot dogs with mustard, you've been eating turmeric. So it's a very interesting plant, and again, just the one I chose to highlight because I have a great slide of that beautiful flower, and that's maybe a little late, but you know, the clumps will put up multiple stems in the summertime, and and all the parts of the plant are fragrant. It does kind of have a spicy fragrance to it, in addition to the rhizome itself. So like I said, plants that do triple duty and are low maintenance are the kinds we love to have at the conservatory. So be sure to make a stop into the North Conservatory at least once during the summer, and later in the summer when this plant will be flowering, and you will see other tropical food plants as well. We're going to have a whole variety to draw you away from the butterflies. And with that, I'm going to turn it over. Yeah, right. I know you laugh. I'm going to turn it over to Cheryl Beagle, who's going to talk about
Thank you. Well, hi everybody. I just chose a picture of so that everybody can get an idea. When we get our butterflies in from the imported species, or actually any of them come beautifully packed like this. Anybody want to guess which pupa that is? I don't know if anybody can see the, it's labeled there, of course, in scientific terms. It's the paper kite, the fluttery thing. So you can imagine that times when we open our boxes, it's like opening jewels. Such a great variety. Oh, and I did include, this is one of the cool new African species that we got last year. I was telling my grandson I'd be talking to you all today, and I said, what should I talk about? And he said, tell them about all the neat new butterflies you're getting this year, but we don't don't know that until the farmers have seen what they are having success with. I did just get today a brand new London People Supply catalog. That would be a lot of fun to produce. But again, it just depends on what works well for them. So I'm just, since I care for the South House, this time of year I'm very busy getting things ready for butterfly season. So I look forward to working with you guys. I think you all heard that we extended the exit area. So those of you who volunteer with us in the Women's Fancy, I have a lot more space to do our checks, and it'll make things a lot more smooth. I guess another thing I'd mention is we just got word that Nelson is going to join us again this summer. So that's really great. I look forward to working with you all or having fun.
Like that's a seed pod. It's right before it opens in the autumn. And it usually is just orange in color. I use a lot of zinnias down there in the conservatories, not just for aesthetics, but I'm feeding butterflies. And without the food, you're not going to live very long. So there's a difference in zinnias when you're picking them out. As you see right here, these little flowers here are the providers of nectar for, that's the food source. And not all zinnias are equal. Now, this is a dahlia type. There's only one flower there. That's no food at all. You're not going to have much to deal with. So to start with the show, the buffet's open. Look at all that. Okay. And then you're going to have to wait in line. Okay. And then that's not worth even buying. So that's going to be, you know, the beginning of the show. Please come down. Take a look. This zinnia is going to be about, I ordered 400, so I'm not going to be very scarce in there. So come on down. And please, I'm looking for more volunteers that are interested in gardening. So please do this with me. And that, and also, at the end of the year, which is another important part here, our gardens start to fizzle, I noticed, so late September. You know, we've got things aren't blooming as much. And monarchs need that nectar to migrate down south. And these two examples here, the goldenrod and the aster, are late bloomers. And they're also very beneficial to our pollinators as well. And these continue on until frost. And it's a great nectar climb. It is perennial and very late blooming. So with your host plant, nectar, you can have the complete life cycle in your yard without a whole lot of space.
Not
very expensive. You know, you can find the annual milkweeds, and I found it mostly at farmers markets, and they do show up, I guess, about June at garden centers, and their average prices of annuals not terribly expensive. But it's really neat to have that whole circle happen in your yard, and it doesn't take a whole lot. It provides nectar, yes, but you know, for people that are limited on space, you know, I don't think that would be a big problem. But it's a large shrub, so people that have small patio gardens, things like the zinnias and the asclepias are the best for small space. That concludes my talk of butterflies.
That to have a pollinator's garden, butterfly garden, she was finding out specifically, you need sun. Well, I am blessed with shade. It's a little tough to have the whole length of the children's garden be devoted to butterflies. So I have it broken down into a number of different sections. The butterfly plants are scattered throughout, but mainly on the sunnier side, which is closest to the building. And what we have here, actually, this plant is no longer being used. That didn't work for me. It's the Mexican sunflower, Tithonia. So that one's
so there are a few other changes. But I have, since it is a three-year garden, I've included not only annuals, because I need to have that constant source of pollen and nectar for the pollinators, but I've also used some perennials, and we have Monarda in there and Digitalis. Solidatus goldenrod up there. These are plants that you're probably growing in your garden. They're not very unusual plants. They are things that grow just for their beauty, but here they're serving a double purpose of also feeding our pollinators. Then another really good pollinator in our area is the hummingbird. And many people have never seen hummingbirds because they just don't have the right plants in their garden. The very first time I had a hummingbird come to my garden was because of this plant. It's aptly named the hummingbird plant. Can you not hear me?
No.
You're doing this. Okay. You've been around too much? Okay. Other things that, mainly all of these are annuals, but we have the globe thistle here, a wonderful plant. Hummingbirds come to that every morning in the garden out here. And then right there is our native honeysuckle, another fabulous hummingbird. All right, to deal with shade. I use a lot of perennials to deal with shade. They are still pollinator plants. We have woodland phlox here. Everybody knows the columbine, our native columbine. And this is blue plumbago. Feels a great way to deal with dry shade. And then to add to that, I have African impatient and gloxinia. It's called hardy gloxinia, but it's not hardy in our area. Okay. Oh, and this is a great, great ground cover for dry shade as well. It's Meehan's mint, another great native that very few people know about. All right, sensory plant to keep children's curiosity. With this, I'm not so much going for the flower. It's more sensory. It's more textures and smells that I'm hoping it will keep their curiosity. The number one plant, of course, is the sensitive plant. I have adults coming throughout the garden throughout the day saying, I remember this when I was little, so we still come and play with it. I have one couple that comes on a regular basis just to touch a sensitive plant. Then we have some very unusual leaves here in the sensitive areas. This here is silver sage. It has massive, massive fuzzy leaves. If you know Landseer, this puts it to shame. Literally, the leaves can get a foot long in the right condition. And then some grasses here and good old bunny plant. This is an amaranth that's just wonderful when it grows. It literally gets 4 or 5 feet tall and these large cascading flower pits. So really cool stuff. And also part of the sensory experience for kids are a lot of water plants. I actually had rice in the section last year. How well it went for the kids, but it's cool for me. What else do we have? We have papyrus and water cannas, curly juncus, curly whirly. It looks like this twisted rope of some sort. Yes, almost like wire. And pedicytes. Those leaves get this big. I don't know why kid can't resist touching something that's that large. And
get it wholesale, I'm not quite sure. You can probably do a web search and try to find a source. But the place where we have it only sells wholesale, unfortunately. Thank you. Diclyptera subarrecta. I can spell it if you.
So we all tried some eggplant, and in about 3 weeks they look like doilies. So we won't be trying any eggplants this year. And there's a few other plants that really didn't quite perform as well as we had hoped. So we are just tweaking the design. So if you would really like to grow eggplants in your yard and you want to try different various chemical controls if possible for them, try removing all the mustard weeds, all the weeds that are in the mustard family. And we have quite a few, like bittercress, and there's like a yellow rocket that's in the mustard family. It's a weed here. So just go be very diligent about removing those plants in the spring, and maybe the population won't be as instead of the Swiss chard, which was beautiful and very popular, I wanted to swap it out with this variegated basil just for something different. Well, I want to try a couple of different color combinations. So the Swiss chard will not be making an appearance this year. We have a red stem celery. It's something new on the market. It should be interesting. And in place of the pineapples, really don't like it above 87 degrees, and last year, we had 56 days above 90.
Yeah.
So by the end of the summer, they couldn't even support their little pineapples. Their heads were in the dirt. So we are going to try with some pups of the original plants, but I'm going to grow them in a pot where they get afternoon shade, hopefully in better drainage. And so hopefully they'll do a little bit better there and still put on a display. The marigold mix, we just wanted to do something different. So I came across this photo of the Dahlia fireworks. And while this photo isn't really wonderful, the image was that I saw. So this should really be quite spectacular. That's what I'm hoping for. Anyway. The Abyssinian red striped bananas were spectacular. starchy fruit occasionally and then die. But it isn't what you think of as an edible banana. But we are replacing it with an edible banana, also that has some red features in it. So, and these will, I think, get 12 feet tall. So they'll be making repeat appearances for several years, I'm sure. And we're swapping out the pepper varieties on the bottom here, just for something a little different. Explosive emmer I've used off and on for years, and we're going to try this white variegated one for a change. But Derek wanted me to show the layout. It's essentially very, very similar to what I used last year, just for those of you who maybe this is your first year. We are doing something different. The Queen Anne pocket melons, instead of an edible melon, which most of them just jumped up and walked out of the garden. So the pocket melon is supposed to smell wonderful. I think the quote was enough to provide fragrance for an entire garden when they ripen. So it is the fragrance part. So I thought that might be a good one. Little Lucy Oprah is returning. She was a real favorite. But we're not going to be using the large burgundy oprah this year. Oh, let's see. And there's the sweet potatoes and the whole spike wheat are returning from last year. And the cardinal, it's hard to replace that wonderful form on that plant. Cayenne pepper instead of a, what was it, habanero. And so anyway, that's just a plan view of what the garden, the fragrance garden will be this year. Okay, these arbors were new last year, and they worked spectacularly well. It's a really good addition to that garden. And last year I grew three different varieties of beans on there, and this year we're going to be doing something a little bit different as far as plants. And that isn't where it is. Oh, we'll do these first. In the yew garden, last year we used the Dahlia Delina Hawaii, and the photo was great, and the flowers really, or the plants just simply didn't produce. So, up with your heads. Citrus smoothie, calendula, park seed claimed that they bloomed all summer, and indeed they did bloom all summer, one or two blossoms. But the plants just looked horrible, so they're gone too. So we're trying a couple different things. Blue Fortune Agastache, which is a hyssop, is actually a perennial, but we're going to be putting it in as a background, more background plant, against the a different marigold. So we'll see how that works. And here we are on the arbors that I mentioned. We're going to be trying some unusual gourd-type, perpetuate-type plants. I know I've tried, I grew bitter melon at home, and it's just a spectacular plant. The leaves are used medicinally for liver problems, and the fruit is used in Chinese cooking, and it's actually good for kidney stones, too. Break them up, but it's also a real favorite in Japanese and Chinese cooking, just for that bitter element in some stir-fried dishes. But besides that, it's really a spectacularly beautiful plant. So I hope the it'll go well with the cucumbers. We'll see. It's something different every year. And this is the plan view of the yew garden, just showing the Agastache and marigolds and sunflowers that I'm going to start at the right time this year. And a little touch of another Agastache called Golden Jubilee, just for its golden leaf color. But the last thing I want to say is, I cannot make these gardens as good as I can without volunteers. My volunteers have been spectacular this year, and the volunteers for all of Brookside have made a huge difference, and we just cannot perform at the level that we do perform at without your help. So thank you.
Who's next?
temperature was just a bit too high, so I got poor germination. So I, reading up on it, I found that just right around Mother's Day, maybe the 1st of May to the 8th of May would be the best time.
Direct
seed? To direct seed, yeah, into the ground.
Okay.
Any other questions? Yes.
Lisa, God bless her. Bless her. She's in Arizona. But she put all this together, and she's taken over designing several of the beds this year, and she put these slides together, and I have looked at them, and I'm not sure as qualified as she to speak with them. But this, she has themes for each of the bed. The 40th bed is that little bed in the parking lot up here when you first come in, that we put in honor of the 40th anniversary. And she's going with a screaming hot theme. So the amaranth, which is very similar to the Love Lies Bleeding that Nikki showed in the children's garden, will be in there. The castor bean, Carmen Cito, which is this guy, and the black pearl and fish pepper. So this is going to give us some bright, dark colors out there. At the entrance, oh, let's see, where does this go? Not sure. Okay, there's some slides missing from what I think. This might be going into the front of the 1500 gate. Some of those plants are just going to be decorative and not necessarily edible, because I don't think petunias are edible, but I could be wrong. Zucchini tigris, and then the sweet potatoes. The Bardman sweet potato, I believe, is a green, prolific one. Tricolor, of course, is growing this bowl. Around the visitor center, around these beds, out front, and perhaps out back, she's going with dangerous and delicious. Poisonous plants we eat. I'll leave this up for a little while because it's really well written. But she's talking about peppers, castor beans, rhubarb, xanthosoma, which are those giant alligator-like things, and of course tomatoes, potatoes, and other families in the Solanum family can have toxic parts too. Remember that originally tomatoes were thought to be poisonous. So these plants won't be dangerous to our visitors unless they should climb up into the castor beans and eat the seeds. They won't be dangerous to handle. But it's an interesting design concept, I think. And there will be interpretive stuff to go with. In the rain garden, which is next to the parking lot conservatory, she's going with your tropical delight. And these are plants that actually have edible parts to them, such as the papaya and the taro, and then spices, turmeric, cardamom, ginger. I don't know the hibiscus, I have to say, so I'll be interested to watch it too. Of course, some of the other plants that you come to see around here. Well, there's the conservatory gate, and this is really just for color bedding, not really a food theme. We weren't mandated to make every single display a food theme. In some places it didn't work. The conservatory gate in particular, it's mostly a drive-by display or drive-in display, and the whole food thing probably would be lost. So we're really just going for attracting the color. And the trial garden in the long bed where the vegetable garden was this year, and that would be the bed that parallels the conservatory. She's going still with the vegetable garden theme and using four types of vegetable, home vegetable type gardens featuring certain plants from certain areas. So as you can see, there are four popular regional ethnic cuisine types: Mediterranean, Central American, Mexican, Asian, and South Asia, India. And these are plants that she has chosen from those cuisines. Exactly what the design will be is going to be an interesting mystery to all of us, since she just chose plant pictures. But the trees, the olives, the lemons, and so forth, will obviously be good sized and probably in pots. With these home vegetable type gardens, with these cuisines, it's not just the food, but also the spices and condiments that go with them. spices. Lisa does apologize for her spelling. The Asian Thai garden, obviously rice, soybeans, whole beans, eggplants, papaya, and the spices we talked about before. K for lime, I'm really interested to see what that looks like in your garden. And finally, she lists this, and I read this a few times, and I'm not sure if she's putting corn and beans in, or she's just making a statement about this is what she's focusing on. And some of these I don't know, but I can't wait for the prickly pear cactus. Noah, here come on, I guess that is. And I just don't know the plants, so I can't wait to see them. I've tried this, and I have to say, I'm not an adventurous eater. And this is just a picture of some of the plants that she's going to use in there. So that's quite a lot of our display areas, and we look forward to some very exciting color combinations and also more adventures to see the flea beetles like these things as well. Or any questions? Good, because Lisa's not here to answer them.
We have some of the richest soil in the world, and to see that there's a small group of dedicated family farmers that, without using chemicals, they're growing organically to feed families in the area and surrounding areas. It's pretty. My name is Casey Spade. I'm the general manager of Lancaster Farm Fresh Cooperative in Leola, Pennsylvania. We're a nonprofit organic farmers co-op. Right now we have close to 40 farmers that we work with.
Best food is off the plant and closest to it as you can get. High vitamins, great tasting. Hello, I'm Aaron Zork, Riverview Organics, also the treasurer of this co-op. I grew up here. My great-grandpa bought this farm back in the 1920s. The neighboring farm was bought by my great-great-grandpa, and it's been in the family since. It's located along Conestoga River. It's a very nice spot. I grow romaine lettuce, heirloom tomatoes, mixed special eggplants, and also starting with Brussels sprouts and celery, I plan to put out some peach trees and fig trees. It's my greatest thrill to see a seed popping out of the ground and growing, maturing, packaging it, and hearing great comments from customers. That's about the best thing. For this area, it was tough for an organic farmer to get started.
We help farmers go from conventional to organic, and we help them, we move them along, they meet the other farmers. There's this whole networking happening within our co-op, because it's like, these farmers have questions. There's like 30 different people they can call. Hey, I got a question. And everybody's like really tight-knit group. Aaron Zook at Riverview Organics will have field days where he'll talk about his farm, and then you'll come there and look around, and like, you realize everybody from the co-op's there, and they're all learning from Aaron. We can have a really tight community that really means something by supporting these local small farmers and eating local. Farmers aren't staying on the farms anymore. They're doing anything else to make an income for themselves, but they would rather be on the farm, and that's what the co-op came to be. We're keeping farmers on the soil that they grew up on so they can pass that livelihood on generations to come.
Working with soil, it's a simple life, and thanks to this co-op, it looks like you can make a decent living in a simple life.
Serving over 600 families. Is anybody here in a community garden at the moment? One person. One person. So that means all of you have vegetable gardens at home. How do you like your experience in the garden? Are you with one of ours, or where are you?
Rich Chain,
one of ours, great. Okay, so let me just kind of take you through and tell you about our program. Let's see, I've got the control here, I hope. It works. This was the site of our first community garden back almost 2 years now. This site was suggested by council member Valerie Irwin. She had approached our director of parks to kind of start to implement this program. She was suggesting that we put community gardens on park property that we were looking at not mowing the grass anymore, just trying to find lots like that. So this lot was brought to our attention by her office over at Tacoma Park, and actually we didn't even know we had this piece of property, to tell you the truth. Somehow, some way, it was being maintained over there. We had bought this piece of property about four or five years ago, and with the idea of developing a small local park here, maybe 10 or 15 years down the road. Valerie's office notified us. We met with the Neighborhood Association, and from the very beginning, this area just gave us overwhelming support for this garden area. But you can see it's just an empty lot. It had a pretty good slope to it. I've got another picture here. So we decided to put a community garden there, and a year ago, or was it 2 years ago, we set a deadline of opening this garden up May 16th. And that year we had an extremely wet spring. We could not get it to till this ground until the week before the garden site opened. We were sweating a little bit, but we brought our equipment in. And one of the interesting things, one of the neat things with us that we've learned over the last 2 years, we've learned how to manage soil a little bit better. This was our first experience with plowing. We thought, well, we'd bring tractors in and plow the ground up. We don't do it this way anymore. Our whole philosophy with soil now, after going through this mess, is we try to create as less disturbance as possible with the soil to maintain that soil structure. So this was our first experience of putting a community garden in. But you can see how it turned out. This was the shot on the far right over there, was the shot the morning, the day before we opened up. We got everything put in, we got the mulch pads put in, we have 33 plots put in. With a lot of our gardens, we come up with an innovative idea for water. Water is critical for community gardens. There's a couple of things that you need for a successful community gardens. One of them obviously is sun. The other one is water, and the other one is community support. Without either one of those elements, your community garden is going to fail. And one of the challenges we had at the very beginning was finding a water source. We knew that if we worked with WSSC, any water source we brought in with them was going to cost us up to or even more than $40,000. We didn't have any money back then. We had to kind of steal and beg. So Ursula came up with a system of an above-ground cistern. You can see it right there, where we put, it's a 1,500-gallon cistern, and we locate those at the highest point, hopefully close to a fire hydrant. There's a fire hydrant right across the street there. We use a fire hose to fill up that cistern for watering these gardens. Every fill-up cost us $4. That's compared to $40,000. Big difference. So this was opening day. And right from the start, from opening day, as soon as we released this group photo from this orientation, this is what started to happen down at the right. People started going out to pick up rocks, and started digging, and they started bringing in compost right away. So within 2 weeks, this is how it looked. That quick, people started planting things. And then as things progressed, we had all ages participating. It was neat to see the kids out there working and getting dirty. And then as the garden grew, it grew very quickly. These were all first-year shots, by the way. You can see how quick things grew. Andrew, this is one of our best gardens. Patricia here. And again, they come up with different ways. You can see the watermelon there, keeping it off the ground. That was one of the other fun things about being involved with this program. You see all these different techniques. You meet these wonderful people that everybody has a different way of growing things. Sometimes strange, but a different way. And one of the things we started promoting right away was year-round gardening. What most people don't understand, in this climate, you can garden, vegetable garden, 12 months out of the year. Now, if you go back to the year of 2009, you all remember the snow that we had up to here for a couple of months. Those plots right there were growing vegetables underneath that snow. We had 9 gardeners gardening in the snow melted, they had onions up like this. They had kale. They had spinach. They were harvesting as soon as the snow left. So we promote year-round gardening. We provide a lot of things with our community gardens, especially a deer fence in this area. Deer fence has been useful for us to keep out deer and rodents. And it also, what we found out, provides a sense of security for the gardeners themselves. There is some big phobia that we always have to deal with. Anytime we build a garden, people think people are going to have their vegetables stolen. So even though there's no deer in the area, we have a new garden going in at Fenton, Philadelphia. There is no deer in downtown Silver Spring. Not that I know of. But we have a deer fence around that garden. And it provides a sense of security. A lot of the wonderful stories that go with community gardens. That shed that you see there is at Sligo Overlook Garden. That shed was donated by a Boy Scout group. They came in, wanted to do a project. They went out and raised $900 in donations from local vendors to build that shed. Four or five of their dads were engineers. They brought their dads in. They got blueprints. They built this thing free of charge for this garden on a weekend. Everything, you'll see the compost bin at the bottom there. Everything that we generate on site, we keep on site. We try to be as sustainable as possible. Nothing leaves that site. We compost everything. So that was Sligo. Now you can see a couple of the other gardens that we have. This is over in Bethesda. This is Bradley Community Garden. Again, this is a smaller garden. It's about 21 plots. It's located right next to Bradley School. This was our first effort of getting a school involved. With this garden, we offer up three plots to the school. We work directly with the principal. Principal has a plot. We have two plots for the kids themselves to come out and work alongside the garden. And this is Brick Street. This is currently our biggest garden, 120 plots out in Silver Spring. This is an older garden. This was actually has been around for over 20 years. And we were asked to take this over and manage it about a year, year and a half ago. And we came in with our guidelines and everything, did some changes. And when we first came in there, it did not have a deer fence. We put in a deer fence. And you can see, again, how big this is, how much stuff is growing here.
Is there water
here? Let me go back here. There is water. We have two cisterns at this site. Yeah, there is water there. And an unusual community garden that we're still working to think about, this is our first community garden on a parking lot. This is located over in Tacoma Park off of Maple Avenue, and together with Tacoma, the town of Tacoma Park, we purchased about 21 above ground containers. We found these out of a company in Canada. They're 2x6 containers, 2 foot by 6 foot wide, and the containers are self-watering. You fill the reservoir up with water, and supposedly, according to their literature, you water twice a year. Twice a year. Now, last year we got started late. This year we've got about 5 of these plots sold already. We're looking at filling all these this year. And it's been a little tricky working with this area here, but it's starting to work out. We have to bring people in to kind of teach them how to grow in these containers. These are kind of freaking people out a little bit, because everybody's used to when we say community garden gardening in the ground, all of a sudden people walk out and see these things and they don't know what to do with them. So we're going through a little bit of a learning curve at the moment with this project. But the town of Tacoma Park, I tell you, has been absolutely wonderful for us. The first garden that you saw, Sligo Overlook, they provided us with a $10,000 grant for the deer fence to put that up. For this garden, they actually purchased these containers. These containers are about $300 a piece on this. So Tacoma Park, anybody here from Tacoma Park? You were. Great. They've been great. Absolutely great. We have a garden up at South Germantown by Soccerplex, back by the maintenance building. This is one of our more successful gardens. See how neat and tiny that garden is? That's all 50 gardeners are like that for some reason up there. I don't know if it's the outer suburbs that are neater and bigger or what, but that's a wonderful garden up there. Just a little bit about our community garden, some key points. When we do rent you plots, they're not transferable. They're not like Washington Redskin tickets. You can't sell them to your relatives or anything. You rent them from us. If you don't want them, you turn them back over to us, and we give them to somebody else. It's an organic space. We started that from the very beginning. We thought we were going to have struggles with that by saying it was organic, but it's turned out to be a great thing. People respect it, and all of our gardens have been successful by being organic. We are very strict. Unfortunately, you got, you did not get a chance to meet Ursula today. She is one of the strictest people that I know. We have to be strict with these spaces because they are park property, and because we have, they're visible from the roads and from people's houses and everything. These places have to look good. So we do not let anybody get out of line. If you rent a space with us, you're responsible for the weeds. We do not allow trash. We have restrictions on the height of things, what you can bring in there. And we have picked out 12 people so far.
Wow.
We are very strict with that. So if you enlist with us and rent from us, we have a lot of fun, but we can also be very mean at the same time. As I said, all gardens are subject to occasional inspections. Ursula tries to get out of